This is the tale of the Three Rivers Coagulation Cascade. In Pittsburgh, our medical students know coagulation because it's where the three rivers meet to make a downstream clot. The three rivers make coagulation easy. Activation of coagulation limits bleeding and promotes healing after vascular injury. But when clotting occurs in the wrong place at the wrong time, as with heart attacks, infection, APLS, and cancer, the outcome may be disastrous. Under physiologic conditions, when vessel injury occurs, platelet plugs form to limit blood loss so we don't bleed to death. But in pathologic conditions, such as atherosclerosis, clot formation is unregulated, blocks the circulation, and can lead to death. On the arterial side, high blood flow and turbulence promote platelet plug formation, so the treatment of arterial thrombosis is an antiplatelet agent. By contrast, on the venous side, low blood flow and stasis promote fibrin clots, the so-called red thrombus. So the treatment of acute venous clot is an anticoagulant. By limiting thrombosis, we can limit disease progression. In atherosclerosis, lipid plaques activate platelets and tissue factor expression, leading to inflammation and thrombosis. By limiting thrombosis, antiplatelet agents limit inflammation and plaque progression. In cancer, tumor cell-derived tissue factor activates white cells. White cells release DNA, proteases, and other proteins to fight cancer cells, but they also promote thrombosis. By limiting thrombosis, anticoagulants can limit cancer progression. In sepsis, pathogens activate white cells, including tissue factor, phagocytosis, and white cell traps. The traps immobilize pathogens, limit infection, but when uncontrolled, may activate coagulation and cause DIC. In APLS, phospholipid antibodies trigger inflammation, tissue factor, and activate coagulation arterially and venous. Anticoagulant therapy limits clots and also limits inflammation and autoimmunity. In these four disease settings, the white cell networks called NETs trap lipid plaque, tumor cells, pathogens, and phospholipids. They limit disease, but they also cause inflammation and thrombosis. Future treatments require understanding this relationship. Identifying those at risk is critical to clot prevention, including hypercoagulability, such as in cancer and sepsis, circulatory stasis, such as in immobilization, and vascular damage, such as in catheters and trauma. Understanding clot location also improves treatment. On the rapid flow arterial side, platelet plugs form, so antiplatelet agents is the treatment. On the slow venous side, fibrin clots form, so anticoagulants are the drug of choice. Disorders of hemostasis include hemophilia, a prime example of fibrin clot formation, and von Willebrand disease, a prime example of platelet plug formation. Those with hemophilia who lack factor 8 or 9 are now in the golden age of treatment. We have novel weekly subcutaneous agents which reduce bleeds and promote quality of life better than any current burdensome IV therapy. Balancing hemostasis and thrombosis is critical for disease prevention. In hemophilia, the balance is tipped to bleeding. The novel non-factor hemostatic drug emicizumab rebalances that hemostasis. Emicizumab is a factor 8 mimic that promotes hemostasis like a puzzle piece. It binds to factor 8 and 9 and prevents bleeding, just as factor 8 would do. My patients think this is a wonder drug. Another sub-Q approach is silencing siRNA. siRNA switches off the color purple in violets, and similarly, fitusiran switches off antithrombin. In a once sub-Q monthly dose, it prevents clots and improves quality of life in heme or heme B. In gene therapy, factor 8 or 9 genes are packaged in a vector delivered by IV and target the liver cell where they commandeer the nucleus to make factor 8 or 9. Some patients have been cured for up to 8 years. Those with von Willebrand disease lack von Willebrand factors, so they can't make platelet plugs and bleed. In women, postpartum bleeding is profound, even despite treatment. We think that's because of fibrinolysis that happens in normal patients. But we have tranexamic acid TA, which has already been shown to inhibit fibrinolysis and reduces bleed mortality in trauma victims in women with PPH, and we're going to study it to prevent PPH in women with BWD.